Good morning, everybody, on this rather overcast Lord's Day morning, but we are gathered together, and even though it's overcast outside, we know that the sun is shining, and trusting that indeed, and as we gather, we are gathered together to worship, to exalt, to lift up, to be put in remembrance of the goodness of God, the worthiness of God, the greatness of God. And by the grace of God, this we will do. Before I open in prayer, just a couple of announcements. Just to let you know that our thoughts and our condolences are with Carol at the passing of her son, quite suddenly. And please continue to remember Carol and family in our prayers. I would like to announced that Ron is home from the hospital, settling down, and from all indications and reports from Marianne, everything is going well, and we're hoping for a speedy recovery. Just to let you know, ladies, this Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock, there will be a Zoom get-together. If you would like to participate and be a part of that, the ladies' meeting, and my wife always looks forward to this time of being with the ladies, either contact me or get the information or through Facebook on our website. Okay, Harcourt Community Chapel, and you'd be welcome to join the ladies. It'll go from about 7 o'clock till maybe 8:30, 9 o'clock. Good. I think that's all the announcements for now. Shall we open in a word of prayer? Shall we pray? Our Heavenly Father, we come into your presence with thankfulness, with joy, asking that you would accept our praise and our worship. We never tire of asking for you to accept. Most of the time we feel unworthy or that our praise and our worship will not even be good enough. It'll fall short of just recognizing who you are, your greatness, your attributes, your grace, your mercy, extended and generously and willingly given to people like us who still struggle. Father, when I think about that, I pray for all of us who may be struggling, going through temptation sore, finding ourselves in a valley, hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Oh, Father, may we confess that struggle to you this morning and would ask that you would be a very present help in time of need to strengthen us in the inner person. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers, accepting the confession of our sins. And now, Lord, as we go to the service, we pray that you would be blessed in the presentation of it, that you would lead, guide, and direct. Lead, guide, and direct my wife, Deborah, in the bringing of the children's story, and lead, guide, and direct in the bringing of the message on this Pentecost Sunday. Into your hands, we commit each one. May you be with each one who will hear this presentation to be a blessing to them, to lead and bring them, hopefully, to yourself, if they haven't already done so, by having faith in the Lord Jesus. But in any event, those who do know you, again, a blessing. All this we ask in the name of the Lord Jesus and for his sake. Amen.
Good morning to my KF3s and my wee swarm. Happy Pentecost Sunday. It's one of the most wonderful things that the church gets to celebrate. Last week, we talked about things visible and invisible. Did anyone figure out my banana trick? Write me if you did. Today we're going to talk some more about invisible and visible and do another illustration to demonstrate that God is more powerful than anything our eyes can see. I wanted to start by reading to you a very old prayer. As a matter of fact, this prayer was written over 2,000 years ago, and people who love Jesus have been praying that prayer ever since. You can find it in Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do so much more than we could ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work in us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Who do you think this prayer is talking about? Who is the one who can do way more than we can even imagine? Jesus, that's right. And how does this prayer say that he's going to do it? Just by sitting back in heaven and waving a magic wand, zap, zap, zap? No. Read the verse again. It says, by his power at work in us. That power doesn't just sit there like a box of Jell-O in the cupboard. No, his power is living and active. So Jesus has the power to do amazing things, and he is actively using that power. And here's the surprising part. He's using that power through ordinary people. That's what he chooses to do. Through kids and adults, senior citizens and teenagers, people with Down syndrome and Oxford graduates, people in Africa and China and Canada, and even people in Buckhorn and Harcourt and Highland Grove. And why does he want to do those things? Because it helps make things right. It helps make the light shine where it's supposed to shine, on Jesus, so we can know the way to go and the way to live. I like how the verse says throughout all generations, forever and ever. So it's not just a Jesus long ago, way, way back in some dark, dusty Bible. And it's not a Jesus that perhaps our grandparents needed but doesn't work for us today. No, Jesus is alive and well, and he's here today. And his power is still at work in the visible and the invisible. And now for the trick I was going to show to illustrate that. Here's an empty jar. Oops, empty jar. And then Jesus comes along. And I've got the net on to filter out any impurities. And Jesus pours, oops, I'm gonna do it over here. Jesus pours his Holy Spirit into us. And that's hopefully what Pastor Don will be talking about more later on as well. So he pours his Holy Spirit into us. And then guess what? Life comes along like the coronavirus. Here we go. Life comes along like the coronavirus, and everything gets turned upside down. Now, our verse said that Jesus is able to do exceeding abundantly or way beyond anything we could ask or imagine. Those of you who have gone to school, taken the law of gravity, perhaps. And funnily enough, this is a side, Sir Isaac Newton discovered the law of gravity while he was under house quarantine way back in the 1600s. They were having a plague back then, and he had to stay in his house, and he went to his back garden. But that's another story. Now, if I took my hand away, what do you think's going to happen? According to nature and what you've always experienced, what's going to happen is gravity is going to pull all that water out of my jar. But Jesus is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond what we imagine. So let's see what happens when I take my hand away. Are you ready? Ooh. The water stayed in. There's a power, invisible, more powerful than the force of gravity that wants to pull it down. So you can see, there's still water in my jar. Now, this is not actual magic. It uses real science that God put into nature when he made the world, just like the real power that he puts into people when they become Christians. The real power that is available to you to bring glory to God. I hope you all discover the true source of that power that is above and beyond anything that you can imagine. It's not about the power. It's about the person. And that person is Jesus. So next time, remember, germs and sin are visible and invisible. So we need to wash our hands and wash our heart.
Thank you, Aunt Deb. That is going to be a tough presentation to follow. I just heard it and watched it myself for the first time. I couldn't add to that. In fact, I said we should just leave it probably right there. It was so well presented in an understandable way and in an exhortive, encouraging way and very practical. So, well, thank you. I would like to also continue with the, and I'm going to try and keep it to a few minutes. I strained this muscle and it's sort of a little awkward, so bear with me. But I would like to just go to the PowerPoint and to remind us this morning, as we think about Pentecost, we are an equipped people, equipped by the Spirit of God. Now, I know we as Christians sometimes struggle with where the Holy Spirit fits in. The word we understand, we read it, it's propositional, it's logical, at least, you know, we can follow along. But when we get into the area of trying to talk about the third person of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, then we kind of get a little uncomfortable maybe, or a little perplexed, and probably tend to avoid it. And part of the avoidance is because we often see the misuse of the third person of the Spirit, the claims people make within certain Christian camps, within certain Christian denominations. There is even what people would explain as being the exploitation of the Holy Spirit for profit. Mm-hmm. I'm hoping in these few minutes that we can just be reminded and then go to the scriptures for ourselves and, like the Bereans of old, check the scriptures to see if these things, this provision of the Spirit, the equipping of the Spirit to the Christian believer, it can be backed up. And of course it can be, in my opinion. We look at the Spirit of God, 2 Timothy 1:7, we read. And just before we get there, do you remember reading in Acts 16:20-25, the Apostle Paul and Silas were full of joy? And what causes us to scratch our head and wonder what on earth was going on? When we think of them, they were beaten, and then they were cast into the inner dungeon of the prison. Their feet were shackled in the stocks. And what were they doing? At midnight, they sang praises to God and the prisoners heard them. Brothers and sisters, I want what Paul and Silas had. When I go through the darkest days, or when we encounter such opposition to the gospel, when the temptation is to just give up, dumb down, compromise. But Paul and Silas, at midnight, after being beaten, shackled, confined, with guards on either side of them, sang praises to God. The prisoners heard them. There's a lot of prisoners out there in the community, and maybe they need to hear the words of comfort, of praise, of adoration, of worship. So hopefully, in spite of what we may be currently going through ourselves, like Paul and Silas, we love the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord has access to us. And even in that place of imprisonment, of gloom and doom, we can still sing praises to God. Another point I want to make. The early church were known, says the Apostle John in his epistles, because they were full of love. And you know what? The love wasn't just when they all gathered together in their own houses or places of worship and gathering, but they were full of love. And here's the kicker: for their enemies. They were able to pray for those who despitefully used them. They were able to turn the other cheek, even under such intense provocation. The first martyr, Stephen, prayed for his murderers just before he died. When the shower of rocks that came his way to silence him and to get rid of him fell upon him. And he prayed for them, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Reminiscent of the cry of the Lord Jesus from the cross when he too pleaded, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. So, the verse this morning lines up with Pentecost, I hope. God has not given us a spirit of fear. I want us to be reminded, I remind myself, but I want us to be reminded, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now notice it is God who gives the spirit of power. It's God who gives the love. It's God who gives the healthy, the soundness of mind. That word sound in the Greek means hygiene. So I hope our minds are hygienic, not soured and corrupted with lurid images that are fairly rampant and easily available and abroad in the world around us. Guard our hearts, take care of our minds. You know, the same Spirit that was given to the apostles and the 120 in the upper room is the same Spirit that is given to you and I. We are reminded that it is the same Spirit that lives within us. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We are not Christians when we are filled with the Holy, by being filled with the Holy Spirit. No. We become Christians when we accept the pardon and the promise of eternal life and the forgiveness of sins, understood when the Lord Jesus went to the cross of Calvary. We become Christians at Calvary. We become Christians at Easter. But we are equipped to live out that Christian life and walk at Pentecost. We are provided for. God knows the weakness of our flesh. You and I, even as we confess Jesus Christ as Lord, are so still aware of the powerlessness sometimes, the defeat, the sin in our lives, the habits in our lives, the addictions that still control. And we've tried to overcome them, a good showing, as it were, it by our willpower and our flesh, and our good intentions, only to find that we fall short or that we give up. And again, we fall into that place of being defeated by, and unfortunately controlled to some degree, by the very things we were hoping to be delivered from. And then the church at large in the world. Oh, the church is weak. I think we're losing out so often. Credibility. The world and its appeal and its approach. We find ourselves, precisely because we are, I think, at times powerless. Now, there's the right use of power and the misuse of power. The misuse of power is when power is simply used for ourselves. Me, my needs, my pleasures, my wants. And oh, I can tap into this, the availability of that kind of power. And well, not for those reasons or those purposes, not at all. The right reason for tapping into or availing oneself and going on a regular basis of being filled with the Holy Spirit is to do the will and the work of God, that he may be glorified in the giving of that provision to us. We will indeed live out lives glorifying to him. We will indeed be available to those in places of need and of hurt or struggle, because Christ, who walked the Sea of Galilee and the shores of Galilee, is now actively at work through his people, through the presence of the same Spirit that was in him, now in them, now in us, to make it more personal. Again, not to do our thing, but that he may do his thing, his work, his liberating, his healing, his restoration through us, his agents, as it were. I would like to I'll just put my glasses on here because the type is small. By the way, as we think about still not working. I would like to, I'm sorry about that embarrassingly long wait. I can understand that people have said I'm out of here if they were already in. Sorry, but thank you who are hanging in for your patience. I'd like us to just again be reminded, the Lord Jesus Christ, Jordan River, Spirit came upon him. That's when he started in his public ministry. He didn't just sort of hang up his apron at the carpenter's shop and put the sword to one side and in the power of good thinking, in the power of his own thinking, embark on his ministry. No, he too was equipped. He too, the Holy Spirit, he too received the Holy Spirit as it descended upon him. And John the Baptist recognized that this one would be the one who is bigger than he, greater than he, the one before whom John the Baptist must decrease in order that the Lord Jesus may increase. And I hope you and I have that thought this morning, to see us decrease in order that the Lord Jesus Christ rightly should be exalted and given and increased in our understanding. The Lord Jesus, the same Spirit that came upon the Lord Jesus at Pentecost, at the Jordan River, is the same Spirit that came upon those gathered in the upper room. Think about it. There wasn't a different Spirit that descended upon the Lord Jesus, a different Spirit in quality and quantity and type that descended upon those in the upper room, or those in that room. No, the same Spirit. Think about the implications, how the Spirit worked mightily in the life of Christ, and then think about the implications that that should have for us as believers, because we are told that no man can say Jesus is Lord except through the Holy Spirit. Don't you know the Holy Spirit lives in you? The Apostle Paul reminds us, don't you know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who lives in you? You know? So all Christians, we have the Holy Spirit. And so I would just like to now close with 7 points that I picked up, I think, from Chadwick. That the selfsame Spirit that had been given to the Son would be given to them, those gathered in the upper room. The selfsame Spirit. That's the first point. The second point would be this, that he would be to them all that he had been to him. In other words, everything that the Holy Spirit was able to do marvelously and mightily through the yieldedness and the openness of the Lord Jesus, even as the Son of Man, as the Son of God, that he, all that the Holy Spirit had been to him, may he be to us. Third point, that he would be to them all that the Son had been to them and more. The disciples, the Lord Jesus was restricted in the extent of his power and his ministry because he could only be at one place at a time, in the company of his 12 disciples, ministering to the crowds. And they saw him. And you know what happened with those disciples? They went from simply being a Jesus fan club. Wow, look at that. Whoa, wow, did you see that? And then the Lord Jesus said, go and tarry until you be endowed upon high and you will do the works that I do. I know, I too. You're kidding. You're kidding. And I think, am I pushing the point? Is this point that not I'm pushing? Chadwick's pushing a little bit too much, too far? But no. That he would be to them all that the Son had been to them and more while he was with them in body, no longer with them in body, but now with them in spirit. The same Spirit that raised him from the dead is now in them. The same Spirit that raised the Lord Jesus from the dead indwells all believers. Fourth point, that he would be to them as the Son had been with them. I've just elaborated on that. I combined those two. The fifth point, that they would gain in him more than they would lose in the departure of Christ. The sadness at the loss of the company of the physical Christ dying on the cross of Calvary, revealing himself over the 40 days post-resurrection, finally going to be taken up into glory in his ascension, did not signal his absence, but the necessity of his going, and that the Holy Spirit would come, that the Holy Spirit would be in them and with them, and it would be as though, exactly like, as though Christ was right there with them. That they would gain in him, point five. Six, that he would be the paraclete, or the one self, the other self of the Christ. I'll have to read this. I've got it on a small type PowerPoint. That he would be the paraclete or other self of the Christ, and through his indwelling, the Christ would live in them. So through the indwelling of the paraclete of the Holy Spirit, who will be an advocate and a comforter, it would be just as though Christ himself is doing the advocating and the comforting. The Lord Jesus said, "Do not worry, do not be afraid. Lo, I am with you always. I will never leave you nor forsake you." These are the words from the Lord Jesus himself, who is the way, the truth, so cannot lie, never will lie. If he says it, it's money in the bank. We latch on to that. We embrace and hold and are so thankful for that declared promise of him. The last point, the seventh point, just as the Lord Jesus, what was his mission? The Lord Jesus said, "I didn't come to glorify myself. I came that the Father may be glorified." He came. He came to glorify. The Holy Spirit came to glorify the Son by taking the things of the Son and making them available to us. John 14, 15, 16, an explication, an expansion on that very thought. The Holy Spirit this morning, tomorrow, the Holy Spirit will attempt to unpack the Christ who is there. Not the Christ of my longings and wishings and fantasies. The Christ who is really there, the Holy Spirit will unpack and declare. And that is the livingness that you and I need. We need something real that speaks of the truth, not in an abstract, airy-fairy, out there kind of way, but in a way that stirs, a way that takes a hold of us, just like the Spirit took hold of Paul and Silas in that prison and caused them to sing praises to God. That caused Stephen to pray for his murderers. I'd better stop there. The takeaway today, please know, ask to go on being filled with the Holy Spirit who is in you. Read the verses in the scriptures that deal with Pentecost, and may you be encouraged to know that you have not been given a spirit of timidity, but of power, of love. And may I say, but I'm sure with expressions of gratitude from listeners, we have sound minds when we believe in the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Sound minds. I guess we could flip the coin, I'd flip it over and say, where does that put those who don't understand and have that understanding? How sound is the mind who shuts out the Lord Jesus, is closed to the Lord Jesus? Anyhow, I'm going on. Let's close off in a word of prayer. Father, we would close off, but first, may we bring our petitions, our prayers of petition. We pray for our chapel. We pray for all churches, communities of faith, wherever they gather, however they gather. The Lord to be glorified, for the people to be blessed in their meeting together. We pray, Father, for Carol, your shepherding presence with her, comfort for the family during this time of grief. We rejoice with Ron, Marianne. It runs being at home, but you continue, may he continue to know the strength and the health over these next few days and weeks. We pray for the ladies' ministry meeting on Tuesday evening. May it be a good time as the ladies gather together to be an encouragement and to build one another up in their faith. Father, be with our leaders. Be with all who have the leadership position of making decisions to do with the pandemic. We trust in their willingness to look to you, to be guided by your wisdom, that the church would have input into this crisis, that there would be an eternal perspective. We pray, Father, for those who are in the essential services, the front line, watch over them, keep them. And then, Father, watch over us this week. We ask that we would be faithful to you and that your watchful and tenderness of care may be our experience as we draw close to you in utter dependence upon your goodness, your love, your mercies, your compassions, and your grace. Accept our praise and our thanks, for it's in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. God bless, and till we meet again, have a good week.